Presenting Benny Goodman and his music.
Here we go. Make this a little bigger, I guess. Evening, everybody. Well, hey, Luann, hey, Chris, hey, Karen. Hey, Kathy, hey, Bridget, hey, Mary Jo, Mary, Martin, Amy, Betsy, Don, hey, Dad. Ooh, ginger liqueur and cranberry. That reminds me, I gotta get a drink. Hey, everybody. Hey, Cindy. Hey, Timothy. I'll make this a little bigger in case Sammy the cat comes back in. Sammy the upstairs cat has been wandering in and out of the place.
Oh, hey, Sammy, it's okay. Okay, come on in.
Hey guys, hey Darlene, hey Rodney, hey Chris, hey Sue, evening Bob, Miles is floating around I see, hey Steve, I'm kind of doing like a bootleg version of what my dad's got. This is a triple ginger and some, oh man, I forgot to change the YouTube title. Title's wrong on all of them, sorry guys, that's on me. So really it says photos from the archives, really this is Women at Graceland. Just have to live with it. Miles and Sammy kind of circle about each other cautiously. Yeah, come on up, Miles. Same thing with Rosie, the other upstairs cat who comes down now and then. Hey, Kathleen and the euphoniums. Hey, Susan, I am having some cranberry stuff. Ginger and cranberry liqueur. Miles has been driving me crazy all day. I try to work on the Hawk book, and he jumps on my back. Hey, Evelyn. You know, the title's not too bad today. We will, in fact, have some photos from the archives. Erev Tov, Lisa. Do you all see the major announcement today about the trading cards? This is just cracking me up. All day. Dude makes this big major announcement that it's he teases it for days and it turns out I'm making trading cards of myself. You know, like Ghostbusters 2 cards. I got Miles up here now. He's purring and purring. These might be mad purrs though. Turn this down, you guys hear Miles purring a bit. Okay, Miles, I need you to sit down, though, okay? You can be up here, but you gotta sit down. Yeah, you gonna sit down? There you go. We'll curl him on up. Oh, Miles. Miles, you are bothering me. Whoa, he didn't even get the rights to the artwork. Plus, you know, when I was a kid, baseball cards cost 50 cents for a pack of 15. A buck if you were buying Upper Deck, sometimes Fleer cost 65 cents for reasons that make absolutely no sense. And now it's $99 for one? And it's really just a picture of the card? Nice inflation there, Biden. I'll give you my own major announcement in a minute. First, I got this guy to deal with. Hey, Debbie. Hey, Shelby. Hey, Katie. See if this got me kicked off of Twitter yet. They're just going on a spree banning journalists on Twitter tonight. That'll be my wife's Christmas tree, Paula. You know, for $99.95, Earl Shive will paint your car. That's a much better deal. 95 cents more. Yeah. A major announcement. Yep. I've been cracking up about that thing. Yeah, Earl Shive painted the weird Chicago bus, too. It was not $99. Miles.
Hey, Rosie. Come on in, Rosie.
Rosie the upstairs cat is making moves towards coming inside right now.
Come on in, Rosie. You want to come inside?
Rosie kind of looks like Priya.
Come on in, Rosie. It's okay. You can come in. Yeah. Can I hear what all this music is about? Okay, guys. I'm going to keep you two out for a bit, okay?
All right, we'll let Benny finish up this tune. Hey, I once paid $50 for two packs of Simpsons trading cards, and all 15 cards were the same in each pack. Sarah, absolutely. Every car I see, it's a major consideration against getting a new car myself, as I don't want one that's white, black, or silver. And that's pretty much everything. Oh yeah, there's a Donald Dump garbage pail kit out there.
I got some garbage pail kits in here, I think.
Here's a number of things I find in this dresser, in this desk. Yeah, I got some garbage pail kids in here. Hello, Aviva. You want a new car? It's better in snow.
All right, well, Miles has not stopped bothering me yet.
But we're going to turn the Benny off for a second here so we can get started properly. So, all right, welcome along. Welcome, everybody. Welcome to Mysterious Chicago Tours. I'm Adam from Mysterious Chicago. With me, as always, is Miles, who, of course, jumps down right as I train the camera on him. So, welcome along, everybody. I'm Adam from Mysterious Chicago. I've been a tour guide and historian here in Chicago for going on 20 years now. Author of such books as Mysterious Chicago, the book Flickering Empire, How Chicago Invented the U.S. Film Industry, which apparently I got a payment for outstanding someplace off in the middle of no place. I wondered why I wasn't getting checks about that or any of my other stuff. Smart Aleck's Guide to American History, that one I still get paid for. Extraordinary, that one I don't. Murder Maps I should be getting paid eventually for, and also the Graceland Cemetery book, 2022 from University of Illinois Press. That's really the focus that we're having today. Now, if you look on the title up there, it mistakenly says photos from the archives, but there will be some photos from the archives. Today we are doing a virtual tour of Graceland Cemetery that focuses entirely on women who were interred at Graceland Cemetery. It's kind of a corrective. The map that they give out there was made a few years ago before anybody at the office was currently there. The map with all of the notable burials has one woman on the whole thing, and it's a 7-year-old. But there are lots and lots of interesting women buried in this cemetery, so we're going to be focusing on that today. But of course, I promised you guys a major announcement. Major announcement. Biggest. I make the most major announcements. Everybody knows it. So my major announcement for you is I made a trading card of myself, too. In the 80s, when I was 8, and my batting average, according to the back, was 450. It's probably about right. But all right, let's go ahead and move on in. So here's Graceland Cemetery, founded in 1860 by Thomas Barber Bryan, whose wife, Jenny Bird Bryan, has this portrait of her painted at the Smithsonian, the National Portrait Gallery in Washington, D.C. Mostly notable, I think, for that incredible dress that was painted on there. This is one of the portrait painter's best works. One of G.P.A. Healy's best works. We'll move on along in here. We're going to move on down past the Sulzers. Past Dick Duck and Chuck Duck, who are not a focus today, even though I love their names, beyond all reason. You know, I got a screenshot of this on my Mastodon. AdamChicago@mast.to. And Twitter, too, if Twitter doesn't explode by the end of the night. We're making our way down here to the Kinsey plot. The older grave that you can see right there that we're just walking around is John Kinsey, who a whole generation was taught was the founder of Chicago. The reason they were taught that, though, is down at the end of the row there, that older one on the far right, this is Juliet Kinsey, his daughter-in-law. This is a portrait also by, well, this is a copy of a G.P.A. Healy portrait. This is a portrait by her granddaughter, Juliet Gordon Lowe, I believe, who was copying a portrait by G.P.A. Healy that may not survive anymore. That happens quite a bit. Juliet Kinsey was just the subject of this really interesting biography by Anne Durkin Keating, and she kind of reframes her. For a long time, people have historians have been brushing her off as an unreliable historian, which, frankly, she kind of was. But she was also Chicago's first historian, and really kind of the founder of Chicago's high society. We'll also cover, yeah, since you asked, we'll also cover some of the others around here. You notice I'm not having my face up on this one. I feel like it's weird enough that I'm the one doing the Women at Graceland tour. We're a one-person operation around here. So, but this is her daughter, Nellie Gordon. You might remember that we went to her house down in Savannah a while ago. She was the one who married a guy from Savannah right before the war, and thought her neighbors were going to make great soldiers until they found out what the rest of her family was doing in regards to recruiting black soldiers for the Union and smeared poop all over her door. But this is her grave. We'll move over to here. And this is down in Savannah, this gorgeous, kind of neglected cemetery. This is the Lowe family plot. And yeah, right there is her daughter, Juliet Gordon Lowe, founder of the Girl Scouts. And that's where Nellie is. Nellie, one of the kind of the missing people, really, from the Kinsey family plot back here at Graceland. Who would have normally been right around here, so that's her mother. Yep, remember we found that just about a year ago. We were down there in Savannah, went and found the house, which is still standing, and the door is brown. Love it. Let's move on over a bit. This woman is usually on the walking tours. She hasn't been lately because of the construction. It's harder. We don't really get as close to her right now. But this is one that I got fascinated by just because of the gravestone itself. Partly, I love the fact that her name doesn't fit on her gravestone. Elizabeth Ellie Gridley Butler. Elizabeth Ellie Gridley Butler was the daughter of a woman named Amy Ellie. Now, you see the plaque here says real daughter. That's from the Daughters of the American Revolution and means that her father was in the Revolutionary War. Her father, Theodore Gridley, was in the Battle of Bunker Hill. Now, she was born in 1826. I got interested partly because I thought, man, if there was somebody in the Revolution still having kids in 1826, and I'm sure there were, but that's going to be a story. It turned out it was. The guy was a pretty old man at the time that Elizabeth was born. In fact, he died right before she was born. Her mother, Amy, was 50 years old at the time when Elizabeth was born. That's a unique and impressive feat in and of itself. But Amy lived to be 99. She lived up to 1876, died just shy of her 100th birthday. Now, I've never found a photograph of Elizabeth. I've never found a photograph of Amy. But I've talked quite a bit about this picture of this old, old woman sitting here who is Amy's daughter. I mean, who is Elizabeth's daughter. Now, it's hard to imagine looking at this picture that woman's mother is not only alive but has another 10 years to go, but she does. The reason the picture survives at all, and it's so low quality they wouldn't even let me use it in the Graceland book, well, that little baby on her lap is President Ford. Gerald Ford, our 39th president. Now, I never found a photograph of Elizabeth herself. I couldn't find too much about her. She stayed out of the news for the most part. She was mentioned the school that she went to, she was in the first class to be integrated. And that would have been very early on for integrating classes. But she said, you know, after a minute or two, it was no big deal. At least not to her, anyway. We'll move on. Now, you're the president? Well, I didn't vote for you. Well, nobody voted for Ford. Now, this is a plot that is presently unmarked, but is going to be marked fairly soon. They're working on that. It's going to be kind of complicated to just put a gravestone on something that's unmarked, but this is a significant one that the cemetery wants to cover. And again, there's no picture of this particular woman. There's a couple of, if you look her up online, you'll see a couple pictures, but they're not really her. It's a woman by the name of Sarah Good, who for a minute was thought to be the first black woman ever to get a United States patent. And we were a little hasty saying that. Since people started writing those articles, other black women who got patents before she did have been identified. They don't really have you check a race in the box anywhere, so it's hard to tell. But Sarah was a Chicago woman who invented a cabinet bed. This was a bed that folded into a cabinet. And there's been a tendency to romanticize this too, like this was the first folding bed, it wasn't by several centuries, or that it paved the way for the Murphy bed, kind of in a roundabout way. But she invented it and sold it primarily at a furniture store that she and her husband started. This furniture store was in the basement of a medical college. And one remarkable thing is she got a lot of lines of credit on her own without her husband co-signing back in the 1880s. You tend to hear that that was illegal. It wasn't, it was just rather difficult. But Sarah Good managed to get quite a bit, including a line of credit at Marshall Fields to buy stuff wholesale that she could sell in her own store. But the reason that we still have these signatures, though, is they had trouble paying them back. That medical school that they were in the basement of flooded, and they lost most of their stock and couldn't pay much back. Eventually, they gave up on the store. Archie, her husband, became very successful as a contractor. But Sarah is here. Her grave has never really been marked. But we're working on that. We're going to get this one marked. She may not have been, you know, I don't feel like her accomplishment is any less because she wasn't the first black woman to get a patent. She was the first one in Chicago, anyway. Let's move around from here. Oh, interesting that I had this one in here. It's been a while since I did this to her. What was this? Yeah, this is Ellen Dudley Root, who is married to John Root, John Root Jr., of Holabird and Root, the architects. Though she had no good things to say about him at the time of their divorce, she was initially an actress in Chicago. And here's this is a portrait of her with Robert Lee Eskridge and Ellen Root in the very act of executing, a good idea too, a dance of the future. So as of the 30s, this is how they thought the dances of the future would look. I don't really see how they're that much different from the dances of back then. But okay. Curious thing about her, she ended up working for the resistance in France. And it's kind of hard to tell exactly what year she died. She died on a ship on January 1st. It might have been December 31st. Some sources say December 31st. Some sources say January 1st. It can be a little bit tricky. Some of these I just have under the first name, and I can't remember exactly which person it was. It's been so long since I did this one. Let's move up here. Oh, okay, I know who this is. Well, this is one. I think we covered this fairly recently on Off the Walking Route. This one is rather difficult to read the signature on this. I puzzled over it for a long time before finding out that what it says is Florence McLandberg. Florence McLandberg, when she was just a teenager, really, wrote a collection of stories called The Automaton Ear, which is either published by the McClurg Company, who we talk about sometimes. This was a collection that was very early example of modern science fiction. Particularly the title story, The Automaton Ear, was a subset of science fiction called the Time Viewer, somebody who invents something that allows them to see or hear back into time. In this case, he invented some kind of an auditory device that allowed it to hear things from the past, and then slowly went insane. You can look this up online without too much trouble. It was the only collection of stories she really wrote, as she suffered from ill health thereafter for a long time. It's a shamelessly Edgar Allan Poe-influenced story, but, you know, when you're a teenager, why shouldn't you wear your influences on your sleeve? Later on, as a much older woman, she wrote patriotic poetry during World War I. Then after that, wrote a lot of letters to the editor in Michigan, in a Michigan newspaper, really criticizing the whole war, saying that if we don't disarm, the whole thing is all for nothing. Nobody really won the war. One of my favorite ones is one that I couldn't find the article she wrote herself, but it was something a little bit critical of organized religion, and somebody wrote in saying, of course, Miss Landberg is a product of the modern education system and has not yet learned the softening influence of religion. And somebody else wrote in saying, yeah, you know she's like 80, right? She's quite a bit older than you probably are. Yeah, Florence McLandberg, you can find her stuff online without too much trouble these days. This is one who made the book kind of at the last second. A guy named Robert Lurch told me about this one being here, and I totally missed it. This is Harriet Hubbard Ayers. You can still buy Harriet Hubbard Ayer dolls in the 1950s or so. Now, Harriet Hubbard Ayer wrote for the New York World, one of the great yellow journals of the 1890s and 1910s. She was the beauty columnist and at one point was the highest paid woman journalist anywhere. One of the highest paid journalists, just period. And she wrote a beauty column that was kind of a very early version of that. And, you know, we wouldn't really hold her up as a proto-feminist. A lot of her ideals wouldn't even fit into, like, the feminism of the day. But she also helped people find ways to gain more self-esteem by giving them beauty tips. That's how we try to describe it anyway. But these were precursors to beauty magazines. My whole generation heard that thing about sunscreen over and over again that had the line, "And do not read beauty magazines, they will only make you feel ugly." That was definitely not what Harriet Hubbard Ayer was trying to do in her column, but reading it now with these things like, it is a woman's duty to maintain her youthful looks for her husband. Not exactly future perfect, but still pioneering. And we'll move on a bit from here. I love talking about Margaret Potter over here in the Potter Vault. Her father, O.W. Potter, was a steel baron. Very, very image conscious. Did not like things that might embarrass the family. So Margaret gave him no end of trouble. Margaret was only 16 when her first novel came out. It was a book called A Social Lion, which was thought to be a thinly veiled critique of the Chicago social world. And it's really hard to see reading it now what the big deal is. There's like a subplot about a drunken preacher that would have been a bit of a shocker to people at the time, I suppose. But her father tried to buy up and destroy every copy. It was thought to have been banned in a couple of cities, so you can find newspaper articles from the year it came out, like little advertisements in the classified saying, "Yes, we can get you A Social Lion by Margaret Potter." But this, of course, was great for her career, and she went on to have a career that lasted the rest of her life. She didn't live very long. She had a very punishing schedule. She would get up at 4 in the morning and write for 8 hours, work at the Newbery Library doing research until they closed, then also had a very busy high society schedule on the side, too. So I kind of think she had gotten into a thing where she was probably taking something to get up and taking something to get down. She died of a chlorodyne overdose, which was a drug that people would take to get off of morphine addiction back in the day. It's also worth noting she and her sister were huge Cubs fans. They didn't live to see Wrigley Field, but they went to every game at the Westside Ballpark, and she'd love being so close to Wrigley Field as she is now. On a clear day, you can hear the crowd at Wrigley Field standing in front of her tomb. We'll just move a little ways over from her. Oh, and my schedule isn't that bad. Let's move around the corner here. This is a good place for me to get a chance to grab a drink. This is a longer walk. This was probably filmed really early when I was first doing all of this stuff. And not sure how long I'd have to do virtual tours or whether anybody would come on virtual tours, but I needed something to do, so every morning I just grab the camera and head to the cemetery. We're coming right up now on one of the most famous mausoleums in the cemetery. This one was designed by Lewis Sullivan. And just about everything we associate with Sullivan you can see in this tomb, the arches, the ornamentation. The tomb itself is a landmark. Frank Lloyd Wright said it was a work of art like a Shakespeare sonnet is a work of art. But we can get a little bit too hung up on the architecture, really. So this is the Getty Mausoleum. It was built for Henry Getty, who was a lumber guy. But in it with him is the last interment in the 1950s was his daughter Alice. This is her in 1915. About the only pictures I could really find of her were her passport photos. But she was a big world traveler. When she was young, she grew up partly in Paris and wanted to be a composer. And she was very successful with composing, too. I even found some of her sheet music and had a friend record it a while ago. So later on, she decided to switch gears. She and her father became big art collectors, especially Asian art, and she became a real expert, eventually writing a book around the time that this picture was taken called The Gods of Northern Buddhism, Their History, Iconography, and Progressive Evolution Across the Northern Buddhist Countries. This came out from Oxford University Press. It does not get more scholarly than that. It's a very scholarly book, too. I believe it's still in print. It's still a source for ancient Buddhist art, and still a very good one, too. She switched gears again during World War I, picking fights with Jane Addams, which not a lot of people did. But Addams was running anti-war activities. Alice thought that that was just going to prolong the war. But during the war, she started a Braille printing press for soldiers who had been blinded in the war. Eventually, she was decorated by the French government for that work. After the war, she went right back to her studies, moved to Japan after her father's death, and lived in a monastery, a rather obscure Buddhist sect's monastery that still isn't that well understood. She wrote a manuscript about her time there, but it's thought that the manuscript was destroyed by Nazis when they took over her villa in France some years later. So she drifted back to New York, spent the last years of her life studying Ilyana, the Syrian goddess of love. Never married, but had a woman who was her study partner. Which, in the 21st century, can give us certain ideas. I'll move over just a little ways from her here. Just down the road. Passing the trees in McGee's. This one, if you remember that tomb that we pass in the walking tour that goes into a hill early on, Eventually, that was originally the McGee tomb, but Mr. Tree, the judge, had all of the McGees hauled out of the place and reburied up here, and sold the tomb to a lawyer named G.M. Stevens. And this is the armor plot. Armor grave plot. What kind of folks are buried in the armor grave plot? Oh, I screwed up the meter there badly, didn't I? So this is Mr. Armor of Armor Hot Dogs. But it's another case where there's somebody else in the plot who is frankly a lot more interesting than he is. Over here is his granddaughter by marriage, Alexandra Galadzin Armor. There's also a, her, that's part of her name. There's also a Romanov in there. This is her, she went by Aleki Armor towards the end of her life, but her proper name was Alexandra Romanov Galzatin of Russia. And she was actually a princess of Russia back before the revolution. Here's a, one little quote about her. Before the war, the family's collective fortune would have paid the national debt. Now none of them are more than just living. But as the Chicago princess says, I would never wish to be rich. It is a great nuisance. I would like to make money, yes, and my husband too, if it is that we are earning it and not selling our name, but just enough to live on decently. And she wasn't kidding. She had eventually, after the revolution, she and her family eventually escaped to England and then to the United States, where she just worked at Marshall Field for a while. And she lived to be, but she did have some fabulous outfits, though. Look at this. It's a picture of her in about the 1930s. It's another more casual shot, but look at the attitude. Fantastic couple of shots there. And you can see she died in 2006, remarkably recently. She was 101 years old. And her granddaughter at the time of her death said that all she really wanted out of life was a hardback book to read and a glass of orange juice in the morning. And that's I thought that was just terrific. Also, she's a cousin of the guy who was thought to be the namesake of Beef Stroganoff and then married into the Armor family. So meat is like a recurring theme throughout her life. Yeah, frankly, I would try to pull off this coat. But man, I don't know where you would get one like this anymore. It's almost like a Fluvog version of a coat. Move on a bit. I'm a little out of order here. We just moved away from somebody I'll probably talk about later. Just the other day when we were downtown, see, what do we see downtown? I totally forgot what we went to see downtown. Oh, the windows at Marshall Fields that is now the Macy's. We got a brief look at the fresco called Spirit of Electricity, which is on the side of a building there, the old power station that they couldn't tear down when they built Block 37, and looks like this on Dearborn. I love this. It reminds me of this building, the General Electric skyscraper in New York. And this shows the Spirit of Electricity bringing lightning to the city with a well-placed loincloth. I would have had the loincloth be a little bit longer just for appearance's sake, personally. But this was sculpted by Sylvia Shaw Judson, whose best-known work is probably Bird Girl, the statue on the cover of Midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil, which used to be in a cemetery in Savannah. Now it's in a museum down there. Possibly because it's too easy to lift up and steal. But I still see, there's a copy of it that was made for the movie, currently at the Cliff Dwellers Club here in Chicago. Now, she is in the plot of her father, Howard Vanderenshaw. We don't really have a very good shot in this version of the gravestone. It's a big green typewriter ball up on top of it with Psalm 23 on. Sylvia Shaw Judson, also her mother Frances Shaw is in the plot. She was a poet. She had a poem published in like the same issue of Poetry Magazine that had the City of Broad Shoulders poem in it. I included one of her poems in the Graceland book. There's a slightly better shot of that one. Let's go see some Ediths. Now, there's a missing space in that plot we just saw there, the Lyon plot. Mr. Thomas Lyon, a finance guy, was the guardian of his niece Claire, who married a prince and became Princess Clara de Chimay. Then she left the prince for an itinerant violinist and had adventure after adventure. She posed for Toulouse-Lautrec. Died mysteriously in Europe, and her burial place is not known. Well, Carol, these wealthy people still come in. Or their great-grandchildren do. Speaking of wealthy people, this is Edith Rockefeller McCormick, heir to the Standard Oil name and money, and then married the heir to the McCormick name and money. It's about the best picture I've got of her right here. This is another passport shot. Quite a few of the people in the book, the only really good picture I could find of them was the one in their passport. I'm sure there are more of them out there. There was just a really interesting biography of Edith Rockefeller McCormick that came out. Now, she was raised in the very stuffy Rockefeller family, then married into the McCormicks, who were no picnic on their own. She and her husband became major supporters of the opera. She believed that opera was a necessity, donated tons of tickets to charitable organizations to make sure that everybody got to see the opera. Also, buried in the plot with her are a couple of her children. The children who had died of scarlet fever, which was a huge killer at the time. And because of their death, she and her husband founded an Institute of Infectious Diseases that worked towards having a scarlet fever vaccine, which they did have for a while, but it was found not to be nearly as effective as just antibiotics when those came out. But also, they developed and administered the diphtheria vaccine. One of the most famous deaths here is Inez, the girl in the glass case. She died of diphtheria back at a time when there were about 200,000 cases of that a year. But then the McCormick Institute of Infectious Disease administered 100 million doses of the vaccine. And now people still get diphtheria, but the rate is like a person every couple of years. Every couple of years a person will get diphtheria, not 200,000 per year. Now, towards the end of her life, she was living single. Her husband had left her for an opera singer of questionable talents. But she made most of the news that she made on her own was her announcements at dinner parties and things that she was the reincarnation of King Tut's first wife. Like, she had pictures came out from inside of the tomb, and she said, I remember sitting in that chair. Now, Edith Ogden Harrison had to say, well, she was just so educated, what could we do but kind of smile and go along with it? She had actually been analyzed by Carl Jung and became an analyst herself in the 1910s. Speaking of Edith Ogden Harrison, let's go cover her a bit. This is the Carter Harrison family plot. This gravestone is now shiny white. They've cleaned it up remarkably well. They were in the process of a long process of going through and cleaning everything here. But this is Carter Harrison Jr. on the side, who was also several terms of mayor, just like his father before him. And mixed in with that is Edith Ogden Harrison, his wife, who at the time was at least as famous as he was. I mean, Carter Harrison Jr. wasn't that well known outside of Chicago, I don't suppose. But Edith Ogden Harrison was famous worldwide. She was the official hostess of the 1933 and 34 World's Fair. She was an author of children's books, but also wrote a terrific memoir of growing up in New Orleans, where the household servants used to take her out to see Marie Laveau, the voodoo queen. And she never quite stopped believing in voodoo. She was never a practitioner, but in her book she would have all of these anecdotes about having seen people do voodoo and seeing it work. And speaking of that kind of witchcraft, let's move to the side here slightly to see Lavinia. So this is Lavinia Lane. If you look very carefully, you can see the name over here. This is the only mausoleum in the cemetery that was built specifically for a woman and contains no adult men. Now, we don't know a whole lot about Lavinia. She's in here with a couple of children and a couple of people that I think might be a sister and a daughter, but I just couldn't find out for sure. It can be kind of tricky because Lane is not exactly an uncommon last name. This stuff is a lot easier when I can't find a whole lot of people with the same name. Lavinia, we know, came from Galena at some point. What we know about her best is when she was in her 70s one day, she busted into Judge Van H. Higgins' office and started beating him up and cussing him out. And They fought back and forth. They broke several windows in the courthouse. I would have beat up Judge Van A. Chickens, too. That guy was a jerk. There's even a case where Wilbur F. Story tried to sue him, and I actually take Wilbur F. Story's side in the lawsuit. That says a lot about Judge Van A. Chickens. Apparently, Lavinia said that Judge Van A. Chickens owed her money. And after they broke up the fight, it was said in the press a couple of days later that Lavinia had recently had a couple of bodies disinterred from her mausoleum so that she could boil them in the kitchen. Now, I've said for a long time, this is probably just something Judge Van A. Chickens cooked up so he could get out of paying her the money. But I do tend to have weird issues with this mausoleum. Like, we tried to see in it one time, because there's even in the records, like, whether her name was Lavinia or Alvina goes back and forth from record to record. I really want to know what it says on the slab, if anything. But this is one that they never open up. That's probably a load-bearing door at this point. But after trying to find it, I had a rash on my wrist for about a week. So I can't really ignore the possibility that perhaps I have angered a witch. Also, this October, when I was here over and over again, my doctor wondered, now, how in the world would you have gotten a UTI? And I said, Lino, Lavinia. I'm just kidding, Lavinia. I'm serious here. Let's move on a bit. I've been through the paperwork for the lawsuit between her and Judge Van H. Higgins, but I can't make heads or tails of whatever happened with it. But here we have Ruth Page. I love this one. It feels like you can see it, tell everything about her just by this picture. This was, she was a dancer. This is a fantastic picture of her in motion. Got her start as just a teenager on tour with Anna Pavlova. A story she told over and over is the day that she first went backstage to meet Anna Pavlova backstage in Indianapolis. And there was Anna Pavlova, the most famous dancer in the world, completely naked and picking her teeth in the mirror. She talked a lot about how good Anna Pavlova looked naked. She went on to do all kinds of things, though. This is her in dancing to Rhapsody in Blue. This is her as Queen Amidala, or something of that nature. All kinds of things. She was on the Ed Sullivan Show. She choreographed the version of the Nutcracker that was done at the Goodman Theater for years and years. And also was never afraid of controversy. In the 1930s, she choreographed a ballet that had a lesbian couple on in the background. And when asked about these kind of things, she would just say, well, if you only did what people think you ought to do, you'd be awfully limited, you know. I think that's a great line. But at the time, she would just brush things off, saying, oh, there's nothing interesting about me, except I lived next door to Brigitte Bardot in Saint-Tropez for a while, and I've been mugged twice. But even then, in her 70s, she was still wearing a leotard under her outfit every day, just in case. Love that. And also, we can look right across the pond from right here. Oh, Krista, where did you want her to pick her teeth? Right across the pond. This is the Palmers, Potter and Bertha. Potter, a department store guy who made a fortune by thinking catering to women shoppers might be a good idea, and built the department store that became Marshall Fields. But also his wife, Bertha, who he met when she was way too young, but went on to become the queen of Chicago society. This is a painting of her by Anders Zorn. She was a great patron of artists and also a very shrewd business person herself. After Potter's death, she doubled the size of their estate, primarily by investing in Sarasota, Florida. And when she first got off the train in Sarasota, there was nothing there. It was literally the end of the line going into the wilderness. But she lobbied to get roads built there, she lobbied the trains to build out there, more importantly, she lobbied other rich people to build their winter homes out there, got involved firsthand in experiments in year-round farming since they had the climate for it down there. And this is just the investment she made in land, too. She was also a big art collector, buying up Impressionist paintings back when they cost a couple $100. So... a great deal of her collection is now at the Art Institute. The amount of value she would have gained from that over the years is very difficult to calculate, I would say. Let's move up the steps from here. Not to mention, Bertha Palmer is widely credited with inventing the brownie, or at least having it invented under her direction. She did a lot of things, but I don't think kitchen work was one of them. She leaves a lot of money to her various cooks in her will. All right. This is Carolyn Kirkland. Now, generally, when in the Graceland book, I tried to have a quote from everybody at the top of the entry about them, but sometimes I just couldn't find one. And in those cases, I could usually find a quote about them from Carolyn Kirkland, who, under the name Madam X, was the Chicago Tribune's gossip columnist for years. Here she is, sitting at a table wearing a veil. This is not the best version of the picture. I actually sprang for the high-res version of this, of her sitting there with what can only be described as a shit-eating grin. Early on, people told her, "You can't be writing those columns for the Tribune. You'll never get invited to dinner again." And she said, "Then I shall dine alone." And there she is, enjoying it tremendously. She wrote columns that she said were reeking with indiscretion, described a lot of people as really eligible bachelors, who we now know were quite gay, but also got involved in things like pushing for better treatment for World War I veterans, and also to save the water tower. It's almost impossible to imagine now, but there was a time when the water tower was an endangered building. The old water tower down in the Magnificent Mile was targeted for demolition, and she helped to save it. Also, her column after the Titanic went down is particularly remarkable, reflecting on things like man's hubris, etc. Human's hubris. So I got time for, let's see, who will I cover? Let's see, this is another one that was unmarked for a very long time. Guy named John Knotts managed to get this marked a while ago. Right up here in the columbarium section, first of all, on the right, you can see Barbara Langtott, who wrote a book about architects' graves here at Graceland, or the previous book at Graceland Cemetery. I got to meet her, and she was just delightful a couple of months ago. But right here next to her is Marion Mahoney Griffin. Depending on who you ask, it's usually pronounced Mahoney, but a more standard pronunciation of that name would have been Mahoney. She was married to Walter Burley Griffin, another great architect. She was the first woman in Illinois to be licensed as an architect and got a job working in Frank Lloyd Wright's firm. Major part of her job was doing the paintings of Wright's works. Things like this, these Japanese landscape-style paintings of Frank Lloyd Wright's architecture, which really are what made Frank Lloyd Wright world-famous in the first place, is these paintings, about something like half of which she did herself. Though she was none too fond of Frank Lloyd Wright, though she referred to him as a canker sore, who originated nothing and copied everything. Was not mincing words here. Let's move up a little bit. Just slightly. Oops. Oop. Well, first of all, down here there's a smaller marker for Martha DePriest. Who was a mother-in-law of Jesse DePriest. Well, Martha was born enslaved. Eventually came to Chicago following her son Oscar, who was the first 20th century black congressman. But this is, we'll just move over to the side from there a bit again. This would be her daughter-in-law, Oscar's wife, Jessie. Now, Jessie, his wife, this is just this fantastic portrait of her. Now, Oscar was elected to Congress in 1928, the same electoral wave that put Herbert Hoover into the office. And it was a big thing at the time that the first ladies would always have teas for all of the congressional wives. So as a matter of course, she invited Jessie DePriest. And you wouldn't think that would be a big deal to invite her with everybody else, but inviting a black woman to the White House was just Like, the guy who wrote the 18th Amendment had a whole thing saying, I deplore it beyond all measure. This is a measure of equality between the black and white races and fraught with peril to civilization. Several state legislatures down in the South actually drafted resolutions saying that they were condemning the whole event. One of the senators from either Mississippi or Alabama started saying he would personally make sure that Oscar Dupree could not eat in the Senate restaurant. Or he said it was variously reported as restroom or restaurant. Now, Jesse weathered this storm very, very graciously, as she probably really had to. You can see here, a gracious yet forceful civil rights advocate for black women during the White House Tea Incident, 1929. And she said it was a lovely afternoon. We just talked about the same thing you would talk about after church. And all of this controversy has been drummed up on the outside. Nobody seemed to mind me being there at the time. Oscar, her husband, was having none of this. He says, I can't use the restroom. I wasn't going to try to, but now I got a mind to go over there and see if he's big enough. He had nothing nice to say about any of these guys. Now, they lived on the same block in Bronzeville where the Marx Brothers later lived. Or about really right around the same time. And also, little Ray Nance grew up on that same block. Grew up to be in the Duke Ellington Orchestra. We'll also cover... I got time for one more, I think. I'll move over to just one more. Passing Isaac Newton Arnold over here. Cover one of the more recent stories in the book. It is The Jewel of Chicago. Jewel LaFontaine Moncarius, who was probably the first black woman to be shortlisted, at least, for an appointment to the Supreme Court in the 1970s. She was a lawyer and civil rights advocate and politician. It was actually Nixon who shortlisted her for the Supreme Court. Under George Bush I, she was a coordinator of refugee affairs for the White House. And it was so well-liked, I still talk to still meet people all the time who knew her, and nobody has a single bad thing to say about Jewel LaFontaine Moncarius. When she died, she was a Republican, but half of the speakers at her funeral were Democrats. Everybody loved her on both sides of the aisle. And she would tell anybody she was participating in sit-ins back before Martin Luther King Jr. started doing them, at least publicly, that anybody knew about. In college, she and her friends would gather up into groups and go to the same restaurant to see how black students were treated differently from the white students. And with that, I still got so many more of these that we could do. We'll have to do a volume 2, I think. But all right, everybody. So this has been Adam from Mysterious Chicago Tours. I haven't listed next week's yet. I got to check. What day is next week? The 22nd? Okay, that won't be like on a Thanksgiving where I have to just do something weird. But we'll come up with something again for next week and, of course, something for Sunday morning. And tomorrow morning, of course, is going to be Find a Grave Friday. I'll have to see how much snow has come down. That might have something to do with it. With who I picked to go find the Mars, I really have no idea. I got a couple of theories, but nothing really firm. So, all right, everybody, thanks a lot for joining me. I'll make this a little bit smaller, and I'll put the Benny back on. We'll hang out for a few minutes. All right, thanks, everybody. Christmas time travel pub crawl. It is about time for Drink Like the Dickens. Lenora's going to be here by then. Check, see if I've been banned from Twitter yet. They're just bad at everybody right now. Okay, I don't see if there's any... I'm not sure there's any new news. Yeah, a lot of major reporters getting suspended from Twitter tonight for reasons unclear other than the fact that they were making fun of Elon, which is like the easiest guy to make fun of. Have I ever done tours in Chinatown? I've done stuff that goes on in Chinatown. I've never done a full one there. But I'm more apt to talk about the days before it was Chinatown. I'm Bedma, Lisa. Velayla Tovlech. Do I know who purchased the first plots in Graceland? Yeah, Thomas Barber Bryant purchased the first in his own cemetery for his son. There's a couple of closer ones out of there. Kelly, before it was Chinatown, it was mostly an Italian and Sicilian neighborhood that kind of bled over into the levee. Chris, there are lots of purported hauntings in Chinatown. Lots of them, partly because Richard Crowe just liked going to Chinatown. And to China itself. I'll stop talking right there. Guys, I wrote like 20 pages of a Johann Hawk book today. I had a good day. I feel good. You guys, if you're looking for Miles, he is right here in this other chair. See Miles? Miles? You have a nice spot there? Yeah. Catherine, it'll be a while before there's going to be a Johann Hawk book to order. Probably a long time, unless I just put it out myself. Which, it's not off the table. Also, I was going through my various contracts yesterday. Even with the published ones, I make so much more off of an ebook sale than I do off of a print book sale. It's not even funny. We're not really supposed to say that. If people ask, which works best for you when I buy your book? We're definitely supposed to say indie bookstores. I make way more on an ebook sale. On many of these, it's kind of, the difference is kind of academic. But if you want to follow around, if you go on the Patreon, you can kind of follow the Hawk book as it is going. Tomorrow, guess what I got for you guys? A naked portrait of Johann Hawk, just what you always wanted. Don't worry, it's tasteful. Susan, maybe. I just had an audiobook. The audiobook of Mysterious Chicago, the book, came out a couple weeks ago. I didn't even know about it until it came out. But that should make the Mysterious Chicago book profitable, I think, or pretty close to it. So theoretically, I might start getting, like, you know, $25 every 6 months or something. No, it's just a drawing of Hawk. Suzanne, that's interesting. Yeah, that would be interesting. That takes a lot of research. To get it, make sure I get it right would take a lot of research. So often I find with stuff like that, finding an actually good source is really hard. Benny Goodman's own arrangement. Now, the popular tune, Thanks a Million. I don't know, it's an interesting thing with Hawk is I really don't know if he slept with any of his wives. There's like no reference that would imply as much. Even with ones who, that he married that were of childbearing age, there's never a suggestion that that might have been an issue. Nobody ever said anything. You know, people were fairly shy about that kind of stuff. But with Holmes, we have a couple of hints. We have, you know, women that he supposedly got pregnant. We have things that his various people said about him. With Hawk, I got nothing. Well, yeah, apparently I got some money for Flickering Empire sitting around in the unclaimed property that the treasurer has. That's nice. I'm glad they sent me a message about that. Did they send it in cash or what? Megan, I'm glad to hear that. I enjoyed working on the Ghosts of Lincoln book. It wasn't a big seller by any means. But, you know, spending weeks trying to trace a story about Abraham Lincoln riding a flying piano is a pretty big deal. Gregory, yes, Hawk is thought to have had 4 kids back in Europe. But the women that he married and swindled in the United States, I really don't know if he slept with any of them. Now, many of them even made a point of saying he didn't make love in any foolish way. It was all a business thing. But plenty of people got married saying it was just a business thing and still consummated it. Maria, I will let you know. Look, Kathy, some were, some weren't. But also, you know, there's like women who are about my age and they're referred to by the officiant who oversaw the wedding ceremony as elderly. Lord's name in vain at Kmart. I totally would have done that. Attention, Kmart shoppers. This is God urging you all to take up Buddhism. Evelyn, I stopped talking about midway through the end of that sentence. Miguel, yeah, I guess next week's going to be time travel pub crawl drink like the Dickens. Still hoping I can interest some publisher in a drink like the Dickens book. I pitched it last week to the people who did Murder Maps, but they were still wondering why I hadn't responded to some notes that I never got about a Murder Maps follow-up, so... Attention Kmart shoppers, blue light special on sandals. So if you want to look like Jesus, now is your chance. As a Mattel vendor, I was in the back of all of the Targets and Walmarts and Kmarts, and Kmart you could die in the back of and they would never find you. I mean, Target's nice and neatly organized. Walmart has no organization whatsoever, but at least they have shelves to put the stuff on. Kmart, it's all just in weird piles, and there's, like, hidden rooms. And now and then you hear a really good fight in the back of a Kmart. It was an adventure being in the back of a Kmart, man. Thank you. Well, by the time the officiant said that, Marie was not in a position to be cold-cocking anyone. She was cold. And also, it might have been something lost in translation, too. It's one of the difficulties with it, is most of the statements people gave, what I'm reading, the way that they're reported in the transcripts or what have you, is translated from the original Germans. Most of them didn't speak a word of English. So there's definitely points where I feel like stuff's getting lost in translation a bit. There's a, within the trial transcript, they'll like argue a little bit about what is meant by a certain word. But when it was published, when an interview with it was in the newspaper or something like that, you just get what they ended up on. And now and then I will find one that I have to really delve in on, trying to translate myself. There's one that was in a German paper right before Hawk was hanged. A hypnotist came to the cell and like was trying to hypnotize him to make it easier for the hanging. And he was like doing this look deep into my eyes. And Hawk turned around and said something that translates roughly to, why don't you look deep into my butt? But I can't really tell if he said my back or my butt.
Hotel in Chicago, and dance some more to Benny Goodman and his orchestra, and hear Helen Ward sing Eeny, Meeny, Miny, Moe.
Oh, Carol, that's cool. I've actually just gotten to the point in the manuscript for the Hawk book now where I have to recap the H.H. Holmes story. Which is inevitable. I mean, it was only going to take a couple of days after Hawk made the news that people realized that his house was close enough to the Holmes castle that you would almost certainly have been able to see it from the porch. And quite possibly you could have thrown an egg and hit it from the porch. It would take a pretty good throw, but you could do it. I might have to, like, go down there again and, like, sit it out. Go down there with some eggs, you know, just whipping some eggs around in Englewood. Won't attract any attention. The cops definitely won't pull me over and say anything racist, what they've definitely never done before when I'm down in Englewood. Any time of day, the bean rings it, Wiley sings it, Wiseman rings it. Even Mr. Crosby sings it. All right, Catherine, good luck with that. Christmas Carol really is Dickens at his best. One of the times that he mastered a gift that normally mastered him, and I can't believe Nick Hornby didn't use that line in his book comparing Dickens to Prince. There are many, many, many instances of Prince's catalog where I feel like the gift was mastering him, not the other way around. Definitely the same with Dickens. Chris, that might very well be. It's one of those things I just really couldn't bring myself to care too much about.
The title speak for itself. Benny Goodman presenting Madhouse.
Yeah, you know, there was just a really big article out about A Muppet Family Christmas, which you can't get officially, like, in its complete form anywhere. I mean, a lot of different organizations would have to come together for the rights on that at this point. Did you mean H.H. Holmes was second cousins with their grandmother or with his own grandmother? But Unless you got the, you know, generally people tell me they're distant relatives of somebody. It's like, unless you got the letters or something like that. Now, Disney Plus has most of the full movie. Last time I saw Christmas Carol at the Goodman, they actually had the line about the coffin nails at the beginning. My worst really large group of kids story is the time I had to get like 200 third graders through Chinese buffet. That was rough. I don't usually work that young. His great-grandmother was supposedly a second cousin to Holmes. Interesting. But there's not much I can do with it unless they end up with the letters or something. Marina, I love that whole opening, but I would say a coffin nail is the deadest piece of ironmongery in the trade, but the simile has in it the wisdom of our ancestors, and my unhallowed hands will not touch it, or the country's done for. He's so snarky. But all right, everybody, it is time for me to take off and get back to work. There are thousands of documents to go through. Those of you on the Patreon, tomorrow, it's a good day to be on the Holmes and Hawk tier. It's going to be posting the coroner's report, the coroner's inquest report on Marie. And on the top of it, I didn't want to just have that be the attachment and the thing, so I took this 1970s drawings of Johann Hawk naked from the waist up, but still. But all right, ladies and gentlemen, thanks a lot for joining me. I'm Adam from Mysterious Chicago Tours. Thanks so much to everybody who's on the Patreon, everybody who's kicked in a bit to help me keep the lights on in the winter. It's apparently, like, none of my publishers have been paying me for a long time, I'm finding out. It's really kind of disturbing to find out. But we're getting it all figured out now, but who knows how long that can take. So thanks a lot for joining me, everybody. I'm Adam from Mysterious Chicago Tours, saying to stay safe and stay strong and stay warm on this snowy Chicago night. But stay spooky, too, everybody. Have a good night. Jen, I know I needed to check it. I just haven't been out there in a bit.